Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Mario Ritter Jr. and Brian Lynn. Later, Jill Robbins explains the idea of hedging in this week's Everyday Grammar lesson. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first,
pieces of bones in a cave in the Tibetan highlands have given researchers new evidence of the mysterious human ancestors known as Denisovans. International researchers examined more than 2,500 bones found inside Baishaya Karst Cave. Most of the bones were from animals hunted by the Denisovans. The scientists studied proteins found in the bones to learn more about the Denisovans and the animals they depended on for food. Baishaya Karst Cave is at a high altitude, or height above sea level, of 3,280 meters in the Tibetan plateau. The researchers discovered that the Denisovans hunted many different kinds of animals for food, including sheep and a large hairy animal called a woolly rhinoceros. The scientists published their findings this month in Nature. Most of the bones were identified as belonging to blue sheep that still live in the Himalayan mountains. Other animals included the woolly rhinos, yaks, small mammals such as marmots, birds, and the spotted hyena, a dog-like creature that lived in an area called the Ganjia Basin. In the cave containing animal bones, the researchers also discovered a rib bone from a Denisovan individual, believed to be from 48,000 to 32,000 years old. That would make it the most recent Denisovan remains yet discovered. The researchers believe the Denisovans killed the animals for their meat. There was evidence found on the bones suggesting the cutting or butchering of meat and processing of animal skins. There was also evidence of animal bone tools. Frieda Welker, a molecular anthropologist with the University of Copenhagen in Denmark, was one of the leaders of the research. He said, "It is the first time we have gotten an understanding of the subsistence behaviors of Denisovans." Welker added that these human ancestors were able to use a wide range of animal resources. Dongju Zhang, an archaeologist with Lanzhou University in China, was another study leader. He said, "I think the diverse animal remains found in Baishaya Karst Cave suggest that this location offered relatively better resources compared with the neighboring higher Tibetan plateau to the west and the Chinese Loess plateau to the north." Scientists did not publish evidence of Denisovans until 2010, when research identified a bone that came from Denisova Cave in Russia's Siberia area. Genetic examination showed that Denisovans were closely related to Neanderthals, other human ancestors who lived in Eurasia. Both groups are believed to have interacted a lot with Homo sapiens, or modern man, and are believed to have interbred with modern humans. Welker said, from genetics, we know they diverged from Neanderthals around 400,000 years ago. Denisovans are known only from remains found in three places. They are Denisova Cave, Cobra Cave in Laos, and Baishaya Karst Cave in Tibet. The wide separation suggests they lived in many different areas. Zhang said their presence in such a wide area implies that Denisovans had high flexibility to adapt to different environments. Another bone found in Baishaya Karst Cave is a lower jawbone of a young Denisovan. It is believed to be 160,000 years old. The researchers said they thought the human ancestors lived there as early as 200,000 years ago. But the piece of rib suggests their presence was more recent. We don't know if the rib was from an adult or a child, nor its genetic sex, said Welker. He added, it was the first time a Denisovan rib has ever been discovered. Scientists say Homo sapiens did not populate the Tibetan plateau until about 40,000 years ago and first appeared in Africa a little more than 300,000 years ago. But what happened to the Denisovans seems to be a mystery. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
American farmers are using an ancient tree from India to produce beans for making protein-rich foods and biofuels. The tree is called Pongamia. It is native to India, Southeast Asia, and Australia. But farmers in the southern state of Florida have found the tree grows well there, too. In some parts of Florida, Pongamia trees have now replaced citrus trees, which have long faced major struggles with disease. Pongamia trees produce a small brown bean known as a legume. The legume can be used in the production of several products, including cooking oil and protein-rich foods. The beans can also be used to produce a biofuel, mostly for airplanes. Pongamia do well in Florida because the trees like hot temperatures and can survive in dry or rainy conditions. They also do not require special additives called fertilizers or chemicals to kill insects and other life that might threaten growth. And unlike fruits like oranges and grapefruit, the beans do not require teams of workers to pick. Instead, they can be easily collected with a machine that shakes the trees and makes the legumes fall to the ground. A San Francisco-based company called Terviva has invented a process that removes substances from the bean that gives it a bad taste so it can be used for food production. The company's founder, Naveen Sikka, told the Associated Press that Terviva has been able to offer Florida farmers a new chance to replace their failed citrus crops. Pongamia, he said, is the perfect fit to help them rebuild their businesses. Ron Edwards is the chairman of Terviva's board of directors. He is also a longtime Florida citrus grower. He told the AP that turning this wild tree into an agricultural success story was not easy. There are no books to read on it either, because no one else has ever done it, Edwards said. In addition, he said, bees and other pollinators that feed on the tree's flowers help support the local environment. Edwards added that an estimated 0.5 hectare of the trees could provide the same amount of oil as about 1.6 hectares of soybeans. The Pongamia bean also produces a high-quality protein that can be used to make many plant-based products. There's a lot of potential for the food industry and the oil and petroleum industry, Edwards said. Experts say the problems linked to Florida's citrus crops, disease, and climate issues have also affected most of the world's top citrus-producing nations. For example, this year's harvest in Brazil, the world's largest exporter of orange juice, is expected to be the worst in 36 years. The Brazilian Citrus Group, Fund Citrus, made that prediction after a period of major flooding and then extended dryness. But Edwards noted that climate and disease have little effect on Pongamia trees. It's just tough, a jungle-tested tree, he said. It stands up to a lot of abuse with very little caretaking. Pongamia also grows well in Hawaii, where it is now being used on land where sugarcane once grew. I'm Brian Lynn.
This week on Everyday Grammar, we answer a question from Kyosuke, a loyal reader in Japan, who asks, I have a question about the article, When Colleges Close, Some Students Never Go Back. It reads, it kind of just saps your motivation to do anything. I was not able to understand the structure and meaning of this sentence. What is the subject and what is the verb? Especially, I didn't realize the meaning of it kind of just. The story Kyosuke read told about how the University of the Arts in Philadelphia closed suddenly. That affected a lot of students. One first-year student there was unsure of his next steps. He said he did not know where to start looking for another place to study. Let us look at the structure of the statement first.
It kind of just saps your motivation to do anything.
The subject is it, a pronoun that refers to the school closing. The verb is sap, which means to use up the supply of something. We often use it to talk about reducing energy or strength. Here is an example.
Waiting in the long line at the store sapped my energy.
In the student's statement, the verb sap has a direct object, motivation. He is saying that he has less desire now to apply to other schools. The next part of the statement is kind of. This phrase is in the group of words we call qualifiers. A qualifier is a word, usually an adjective or an adverb, that changes the meaning of another word or phrase. Some qualifiers strengthen the force of a statement, like very and to. Others weaken the force, like somewhat and seem. In his statement, the student uses kind of just before the verb sap to show he is not firmly saying that the event has had this effect. We can say he is hedging. A hedge in language is often a way to express uncertainty or reduce the force of a statement. For example, if you do not want to stay at a party, you might tell a friend,
"I'm kind of tired. Can we leave the party a little early?"
You are not saying you are very tired and need to leave immediately. You simply want to introduce the idea of leaving early. Using kind of is one way that speakers preserve their relationships with others. For example, a friend asks you if you like the band playing at an event. You might answer,
"Their music is okay, but it's kind of loud for me."
You might think the music is much too loud or even bad, but if your friend likes it, you do not want to hurt their feelings. So you can hedge or protect their feelings by using kind of. Another part of the statement our reader asked about is the word just. It is also a qualifier. Just can change the meaning of the words that follow. In such a case, it can mean nothing more than or only. For example, if you are at an event with a friend, they might ask,
"Why do you keep checking the time? Aren't you enjoying the show?"
You might answer, "I just don't want to miss the last bus. It's getting late." I hope this helps you understand the expression better, Kyosuke. Do you have a question about English grammar? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. And that's Everyday Grammar. I'm Jill Robbins.
Jill Robbins is here now to talk more about this week's Everyday Grammar lesson. Hi, Jill. Thanks for joining me.
My pleasure, Ashley. I'm always up for a chat about grammar.
Your Everyday Grammar lesson this week talked about hedging, or using phrases like kind of just. I wonder if you could tell us some other expressions similar to that one.
I sure can. What we should understand is that these are all ways to be more polite or show some caution when we speak. You just used one there. I wonder if.
Okay, so if I said, "Could you tell us about some other ones?" That is less polite, right?
Right. Let's think about a common request. I want you to go to lunch with me. I ask, "Ashley, can you go out for lunch today?" Tell me politely that you're too busy.
Okay, here it goes. "I'm sort of busy with the podcast. I may be able to go tomorrow, though."
That's perfect. You used two hedging expressions, sort of, it's a lot like kind of, and may. You didn't make a firm commitment to go to lunch tomorrow. And the best thing is, you didn't hurt my feelings by simply saying, "No, I can't go."
When you think about it, we use a lot of hedging expressions in English, don't we?
Yeah, that's why it's important to understand how they're used, so your speech sounds more native-like.
Well, thanks for being with us today, Jill. And thank you for that lesson.
Anytime, Ashley. You can say, "I'm kind of just waiting for you to ask me again."
I will definitely talk with you again soon.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Ana Mateo.
In today's podcast lesson, we're going to visit a beekeeper with Ana. She learns all about how to care for bees. And we learn about conditional statements in English. Those are statements with if and a modal, such as the words will or would.
But Ana has a little problem. She is afraid of bees. As Lesson 12 of Level 2 begins, Ana is sitting with Kaveh at an outdoor cafe.
Wow! Did you know that bees are dying?
That is bad news. If all the bees died, there'd be no food. Bees are very important.
Yes, they are. Speaking of bees, one of our little friends is here now.
You know, Ana, if you ignore it, it will fly away. But if you swat it, it might sting you.
I'll ignore it. I can ignore it. See? I'm ignoring it.
Ana, are you afraid of bees?
What makes you say that?
Ana, you should call my friend Caroline. She's a beekeeper and a bee educator. If you talk to her, she'll probably help you get over your fear of bees.
I'm not afraid of bees!
Here's her card.
Kaveh gives us our first examples of conditional statements here.
You know, Ana, if you ignore it, it will fly away. But if you swat it, it might sting you.
Notice that he uses the modal will. And this is what we call a type 1 or real conditional. That is when you talk about a real event and a result that will probably happen. The form is the word if plus a present tense verb followed by will plus an infinitive.
So the real event is Ana ignoring the bee, and the result is the bee flying away. That's easy to understand. Andrew, I hope we don't worry our listeners with all the types of conditional statements in this podcast.
No, don't worry. We're not going to do that. We're only going to talk about two kinds today, type 1 and type 2.
That's good. If we go back to the beginning of the conversation, we also hear Kaveh saying,
if all the bees died, there'd be no food.
That's a type 2 conditional, isn't it, Andrew?
Yes. Type 2 conditionals can have a possible event and a result that may or may not happen, or they can talk about something that is not real or imaginary. For example, I could say, if I were president of the United States, I would live in the White House. So here is the pattern. The word if plus a past tense verb plus a modal such as would or could plus the infinitive form of the verb.
So the bees have not died, thank goodness, but that part of the statement uses a past tense verb. Let's see if we can find some more examples and see how Ana does at the beekeeper's house.
I think I'm at the wrong address. This does not look like a place where bees are kept. Oh, sorry to bother you. I'm looking for beekeeper Caroline. I'm here to take her Learn to Love Bees class.
You're in the right place. I'm Caroline.
Oh, nice to meet you. Caroline, I thought this class used real bees and real hives.
It does. If you look in my backyard, you will see my bees. I'm a home beekeeper.
What? You live with bees? That is really amazing and at the same time really scary.
It's not scary. If you come, I'll show you.
Caroline, how many bees are in that hive?
About 30,000 in each.
Caroline uses the word scary. That means the same thing as frightening or causing fear. I think all of us have had to overcome fears at one time or another in our lives. I was also once afraid of bees, and then I learned that if I ignored them, if I did not bother them, they would not bother me. And I overcame that fear. How about you, Jill?
I was afraid to go deep underwater, but I learned how to do it the right way in my scuba class.
In the next part of the lesson, listeners, notice the way Anna and Caroline use conditional statements by listening for the word if. Anna is telling a story about why she is afraid of bees.
What? That's amazing. But aren't you afraid they're gonna come out and kill you?
Not at all, Anna. Even my children help me. Tell me, why are you afraid of bees?
I don't know. Well, when I was a little girl, my mom ran out of honey, and I really wanted honey for my pancakes. So I climbed high into a tree and hit a beehive with a stick several times. Then I reached inside with my bare hands to pull the honey out. That's when I got stung a lot. Caroline, if you hit a beehive with a stick and reach inside, you might get stung.
No, Anna, if you do those things, you will get stung.
Yes, I did.
And you know that it was your fault you got stung, don't you?
Yes, I did.
Bees know your feelings. And if you stay calm, the bees will be calm. If you're nervous, the bees will be nervous. And if bees are nervous, they may sting. So please, be calm.
I will be calm. I am calm. Okay, I'm ready. I'm ready.
Great, let's get our equipment on.
Okay, wait, I'm not ready. I'm not calm. I'm nervous. Give me 1 minute to be calm.
Be calm. That's the first step, isn't it, in overcoming our fears? I noticed that Anna uses might in one of her statements.
Caroline, if you hit a beehive with a stick and reach inside, you might get stung.
Yes, but Caroline corrected her. She is certain that bees will sting if someone hits their home with a stick.
No, Anna, if you do those things, you will get stung.
I think we should review our conditionals and give our listeners some practice now.
Good idea. I'll say a situation, then pause, and our listeners can try to complete the statement.
I'm ready, and I'll say what type it is after I finish the statement.
Okay, here's the first statement. If you go out in the rain without an umbrella,
you will get wet. Type 1.
If you feed a cat,
it will want to stay with you. Type 1.
If the sun didn't shine,
the earth would be very cold. Type 2.
And here's one more. If your car has no gas,
you won't be able to drive it. Type 1.
Good job, listeners.
Next time, we'll see what happens when Anna meets the bees at Caroline's house.
I think I can guess. If Anna stays calm, the bees will be calm too. Now, listeners, have you overcome a feeling of fear that you had when you were younger? Write to us and tell us about it at learningenglish@voanews.com.
And remember, you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.